First of all, thank you so much for enrolling for this today's speaker series. So let me introduce myself. I'm Shrija Santanam, community manager working with DC Cap. Hope like everyone is doing good and safe. Let me give you a quick intro about DC Cap, the organization behind this beautiful initiative speaker series. So DC Cap is a digital commerce agency helping businesses and brands abroad to create e-commerce storefronts. So that said, during this challenging times, being in the lockdown, it's very important for every one of us to upskill and learn new things to facilitate learning for our employees as well as for the general community. DC Cap started hosting speaker series, a virtual event. So that happens every Friday. Through speaker series, we bring in distinguished thought leaders, technology masters, and change makers around the globe to address the varied topics which matters to the community most. So that said, I'm glad to welcome Badmini Janaki, the founder of the broadcast. First of all, thank you so much, Badmini, for accepting our invitation, for honoring our stage. Badmini Janaki is a product and growth enthusiast with 9 years of experience in consumer behavior, UX, and product management. Through her career, she has won many hats such as visual designer, user experience designer, and now product manager. She also runs a product media line called The Broadcast that hosted some of the most inspiring people to discuss building products. And today she is here with us to speak why unhappy customers are the best. I hope like you guys will have a great session today. And over to you, Badmini. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shrija and DC Cap. First of all, it was a very well-organized event, I would say. It was well thought, well followed up, and well templatized and executed. Thank you so much, Shrija, for doing that. And thank you so much, DC Cap. I'm personally a big fan of Karthik and his leadership styles and how much he gives importance to reading books and people. And I have personally did my podcast with him, and definitely one of my mentors, I think, is. So very happy to be here in a Friday evening. And thank you very much for all the people who are attending, because in a Friday evening, to convince yourself for upskilling yourself, or you know, to even attend a webinar for 30 minutes or 40 minutes is not easy at all. For me, it takes a different talk to really convince myself, but I really, really appreciate. I would love to read everybody's name, but thank you so much, people who were, I know, I think Hari Kumar, Janani, Gopi, Barish, Bhavani, and all of you. Hope I really do justice for all the sacrifice that you have done on a Friday evening. So that's pretty much about me. Perfect. So why unhappy customers are assets? You would have been like little piqued around why unhappy customers are assets, because they are some nudge when you are making a purchase and when you are doing anything. Like even if in, let's say in your office, I'm sure you all can relate to the situation. They're going to give a free ice cream, all right? Free ice cream to all the employees. Even then, there will be 10% of a butterscotch ice cream. I so wish it was from Haagen-Dazs. I'm very sure there are like 10% of people who are saying that and then being that nudge, even when you're giving a free product. But when somebody is like buying a product, they will talk even more. They will expect when they spend 100 rupees or $100, they always want the 200 rupees or $200 from the whole of purchase. So it's going to happen. It's very natural. But how can you make the conversation constructive? How can you make the whole thing useful is what we're going to see now. Let me just open my chat box also. Okay, fine. So I'm going to see that. And then let's go on to the presentation. Why me? Why somebody like me should talk about it? To give a bit of a background about me, I started my career as a visual designer. In like anybody in Chennai, I also joined Cognizant as a visual designer, and then I moved to PayPal and I worked at PayPal for 7 years. started as a UX designer, UX researcher, and then as a product manager. All through that career, I've been, fortunately or unfortunately, I've been always dealing with this unhappy customers, right? My predominant job, most of the years, was to reduce the unhappy customers. If there are going to be 10 unhappy customers last month, my job as a product manager to build a platform, how can I reduce the unhappy customers? Let's say in PayPal, my use case was like, let's say somebody is buying a white shirt and I end up getting a blue shirt. Now that customer is clearly unhappy, and this customer will do anything to bash the value and the brand of PayPal, as well as the marketplace or the merchant that they purchased with. They are furious. They can do anything. They can go, post about it on social media and say things about the company to anyone. Do all that. The first step that they will do is make a call. But have you ever thought that each and every call that we are making to the customer service is costing them a lot of money? If it's going to be a US company, it's going to cost them around $4 to $7. If people are buying products for $2-$3 and then making call for $4 to $7 every single time, it's going to bring in a lot of huge loss to the company. Thanks to the universe, that we have a lot of customers like that. I've interacted with a customer who purchased the product for the new year for $8 and made 42 calls when they never got the product. Just imagine, they bought a product only for $8. So how do you handle customers like that? How do you manage customers like that? And after PayPal, I have started taking up product management consulting work. Even then, with the customers I've interacted with, they always want the best. They are super unhappy, even if there is one small turnoff. And they always see places that, as a human, we always see for what's wrong. But when you're a customer, you become like 10x of what it is. So that's pretty much my background on what I have done at PayPal and with my customers now. Now I handle clients who are Renew Asia and chatbot platforms like DCPC. And there's one more called Wildflower, which is a pregnancy tracking app. These are my clients where I am helping them launch their products in India. Again, the same problem. So let's see what kind of customers are. So when it comes to customers, right, let's get one thing straight. They are selfish, they are very demanding, they are ruthless, and they are absolutely disloyal to your brand. These are like very clear. Ever since the barter system days, these are like the basics. They are never going to be very nice to you, even when you are trying to keep them more. But the basic is, customers are always right. Customers are the king. Whatever they're going to do, they are at least being loyal to their desires. So it's a basic thing. They don't really care what kind of a brand you are. Are you big? Are you small? Are you just trying to start up and then they want to help? Very few of them would really think, oh, wow, this guy is like just starting and she is probably a startup who just raised 400K. Let me not just do this disputes. No, not many are going to really think. They are only loyal to their desires. But can we just stop getting any feedback from them because they are anyway ruthless? They are anyway not loyal. Can I just ignore their whole feedback? Maybe not, because of one reason. Because that is if you are right, if you need to build upon something, if you need to improve your product, or if you need to stop something or start something. So this 10 to 20% of the people are super critical. Of course, the people who are going to tell you are amazing are going to encourage you. Absolutely, yes. But these people, these guys, the 10%, 20% of guys who are going to tell you suck are really, really important to your business. You can never ignore. So there is an analogy about getting a feedback, right? It's like a life of a cat on a wall. On one side, you want your product to be respected. You want you to be respected. Nobody wants to trash your brand and they want to keep saying, oh, this is a nice product. But You also want to know loyally what really happening inside your product. You want to get the feedback so you can improve on it, because there is always a room to improve. As a business, you know. As a product manager, you know. As a salesperson, you know. You could be in any discipline. Even when you are a customer service agent, you know that you need that little pinch of salt to actually value your own product and improve your own product. So it is a little tricky to really get that feedback and actually take that whole essence of it and not get demotivated or not get take it to the heart and become very sensitive about the whole product. But it's an art. Okay, Padmini, it's been there. Yes, like you said, customers have been this ever since the barter system days, ever since things have been sold as a transaction. This is how customers have been like. Why are you taking this up as a very big topic now and then, you know, talking about it now in 2020? I'll tell you, the customers, yes, the sector of customers been there, but now they are evolved to big extent. They are very knowledgeable. You know, when they, even before you go tell them hi, even before your chatbot tells them hi, how can I help you? They have researched about you. If they've been to your physical store, if any, they've visited your website, chatbot, seen where you work, who are your clients, what is their success. They've pretty much done everything, even if you're a B2B customer, B2B sector or a B2C sector. No matter what, they have done all the research. They are even more empowered than they were in 2010. Things were like, we're talking about just 2010. Just 10 years back, when probably we know what's been happening in the internet world, what's have been happening in the dot-com world. Things have changed with social media. People are so informed. Now, even if you leave that 1% of unhappy customer, they'll make sure they'll ruin your whole brand. Even that's a secondary. Even if you are able to suffice and make that 1% or 5% customers happy, they will stand up for you. They will become your brand ambassador to argue any brand. Whenever there is a conversation, right? They will become your voice if you can keep them happy. So these people are very critical. So, okay. It's very simple. Gone are the days when we were doing business for money. These are days when we are doing it for customers. If you keep the customers happy, everything is going to come into place. Money is a byproduct. Brand is a byproduct. Popularity is a byproduct. Even funding is a byproduct if you're going to keep your customers happy. So it's not going to be, you know, very difficult at all. It is very simple, but to underline that, simple is also difficult. When we say simple, it is not easy. I'm saying we can make it simple, but it is going to be still difficult. Okay, let's make it a little more interactive. On the chat section, tell me one person who is absolutely customer obsessed that you know. It could be somebody from your company, somebody that you follow on LinkedIn, or somebody who's a CEO of top companies or any company. On the chat box, tell me who is your favorite customer obsessed person. I'm gonna have the chat box open. Okay, the question was, name one of your favorite customer obsessed person, somebody whom you follow on LinkedIn. It could be some CEO. It could be anybody who you work with. They're just their names. Okay, Jeff Bezos. Nobody else is able to think of anybody. Mr. Sridhar Vembu, yes. Okay, I'll leave it right here. Elon Musk, yeah. Okay, so when I asked about some of you had told Jeff Bezos, Sridhar Vembu, Elon Musk, and all of it. But do you know that why nobody said it is me, that's yourself? Like, all of us are supposed to be customer obsessed, isn't it? Isn't it? Somebody, I think someone saw the next slide and then said it is Jeff Bezos. Very nice. So Jeff Bezos, so one of my favorite company who are absolutely you know, customer obsessed is Amazon. I'll tell you why. When I was the product manager for PayPal, when I was into disputes and claims, I was researching about a lot of other companies who were doing the same thing. And I analyzed that 97% of the customers of Amazon who are unhappy. I mean, I'm not saying the whole unhappy customer, whole customers versus 97% are unhappy. Let's say they have 2-3% of unhappy customers. That 2-3% take it there and make it as 100%. From that 97% of the customers, they become unhappy to happy customer at any rate. Like they, it's not that they are absolutely unhappy with Amazon service that they will stop buying. Nothing of that sort happens. Mostly they are made happy because it's one of the most customer obsessed company that we've ever seen. In that case, whatever they make as a product should have become, you know, successful, isn't it? Because they know about the customers. They talk to the customers. They are customer obsessed. Yes. They listen from the customers. Yes. Their customer service systems are very tech enabled, that it is super automated. Not many human interaction is happening. The portals are done so well that it is automatically determining the disputes and claim. Everything is taken care. But still, when they came up with Fire Phone, they were a big failure. Can someone tell me why? On the chat box again. I'm going to just give five to ten seconds. If someone is going to give a very good right answer that convinces me, I'm going to send them a book. Physical book to their home once the courier companies are opening up. Nobody wants to participate. There was no human touch in customer feedback. Mm-hmm. Not understanding the need of customers. Anybody else? Let's make it interactive, guys. Come on. If this was in live session, then I would have behaved like a tuition akad and asked you to just get up and give the answer. But you know, unfortunately, this is a webinar. My question was, Amazon is an absolutely a good company, which is having a very good understanding towards the customers. But still, when they launched Fire Phone, it was an absolute failure. Do you know why? I mean, you don't have to tell me the correct answer. You don't have to Google now. You can give your perspective if you know. Okay, fine. Okay, I think we've got some decent answers. Yes, decent answers. So yes, basically the one problem was They listened to the customers so much. I think they just went with whatever the customers said. So, you know what the problem is? Customers, most of the times, they don't know what they want. They will say, yeah, I want a product where all the apps are loaded just on the screen, where I want a map that is like taking me on 3D. Yes, yes, I want all the Amazon products to be loaded right there, along with the music. Yes, I want all. So this is how customers behave when you ask them for what you want, right? This is one of the famous Henry Ford quote. I think Henry Ford told this. If I had asked people what they wanted, they would have said faster horses. I personally, as a product manager, really, really love this quote because I've heard people talking on the phone. I've been there in multiple countries where they say things. They always say things that I want this, I want that. But, you know, in person, if you are going to come up with a product, they will usually be, oh, okay, are you going to pay for it? Then people just think about it. Oh, am I supposed to be paying for it? I thought you asked me questions and I can answer. Now I have to pay for it, for this product. I think I will buy an iPhone. or I think I will go with a quality phone like iPhone for whatever reason it is, right? So there is a huge gap between what they are asking for and what they really want. And the huge gap is usually that data. How many people are really asking for it? Data between the qualitative and the quantitative research that we might have to do. So in that case, okay, the last one is fine, but this one, let's say anybody knows this, right? At least I'm going to give you that same book that I was telling you. Do you know this woman's name? This lady's name? Nobody knows. Bhavani. Yes. It's Marissa Mayer. Hey, any clues? Wow. Melissa, who is that? Good, good, good. So it's Marissa Mayer who was the CEO of Yahoo sometime back. Before that, she used to be part of Google. And she's pretty famous. You have not read her book about Marissa and the fight to win back the Yahoo. I think win back the Yahoo. Win Back the Yahoo is an amazing book. I've read it a year back. It was definitely an eye-opener on how women can be a leader, still try to accomplish what she is and what an asset of women can win. It's an absolute good book. So wherever I go, I keep giving a lot of book suggestions, but this book is definitely a very good read. Let's coming back to this topic, right? This deal between Tamlan and Yahoo was one of the famous deal of Yahoo's when Yahoo was like really going downside. The deal they got for was Yahoo bought Tumblr with the pure data. Like, you know, at that point when Yahoo was really waiting for that sailboat or some lightsaber in mid of the sea, they bought this whole Tumblr for $1.1 billion, which is a huge money, especially in the times that they were living in, just for 30 million millennial users. They thought, you know, buying Tumblr, Yahoo can get back that 30 million millennial users and Yahoo can just start breathing again. But something happened that people literally stopped using Tumblr. Tumblr used to be a very big hit for the micro blog sites. And for some reason, after this whole deal happened, I think as a customer, as a user, when I say, I really think people stopped using it to a drastic number. So this deal, this whole deal actually went with the whole data went with this, but still this didn't work, right? What could be the reason? So there they listened to the whole customers. Here they believe totally on the data. So what exactly to be done? Both really didn't work out well. So how are we supposed to really use this data of customers, tag it with the data and customers' feedback, tag it with the data and come up to a solution? One thing that you can do is thinking in the systems. I'm sure you've heard of this story and five blind men. I don't want to bore you with the same story again, where when a blind man touches the ears, he says, the elephant looks like a fan, and a blind man touches the drum, he says, elephant looks like a big snake. And someone who touched the leg said, elephants probably look like a pillar. But only someone who know the full picture can really decide between the customer feedback and data and come up with a solution and come up with a whole solution of the whole rhythm of unhappy customers are the essence. Otherwise, it becomes just a humiliation of somebody scolding you. You just take it up, just build because they are scolding you. Without data, it will not take you anywhere. I'm going to share my own personal experience here, which is very small. Some of you might have also known if you attended one of my previous conversation talk. Yeah. So when I joined, when I stopped working at PayPal, I joined a company called Change Healthcare. That was my first client, where I was working for them, and they were building some healthcare payment products for the company. And I had to interview a lot of customers who a city called St. Louis in the US. So when I went there, I was interviewing a lot of people, old people, younger people, a lot of them. You know, when I was interviewing, I was talking to this particular customer who was 16 years old, who is a teen pregnant, who already has a kid, who is a teen mother, who was a teen pregnant for so long. And, you know, she was telling, I think you should come with the credit product and we are earning very less through our Uber rides and all that, because her boyfriend goes for an Uber ride and she works in a departmental store, I believe. So we are earning lesser than 20K per annum and we are not able to afford the healthcare product. I think you should come up with a credit product. You know, for someone like me, who is going from South India, from Chennai, to listen to it, I'm like 16 year and you are pregnant and already you have a small kid. And this is US. And this is so new to me. Not necessarily something that I have seen with my friends or my own case. Like when I was 16, I was probably the only trouble I had was which department I would take, science or commerce. That was the only problem I probably had in my life. And this girl is having a problem of credit system versus going to Medicaid or Mediclaim for her 3 months, 6 months old kid. And here she is for the interview for some incentives. Absolutely different ecosystem, absolutely different culture of students, people. And here, if I take a decision totally with what she is saying, it will go wrong. It might go wrong because she is probably a smallest sample size. If I go with my own intentions as a person or as a mother who is probably 28, 29 years old, who have seen life to an extent, seen teenage and early 20s, that might again go wrong because culturally I'm from a different place. This is not something that happens to my neighbor every single day. This is not something that happens to my cousins every single day. Culturally, I'm so different. But again, this one thing I can of course see is this customer saying something with the data of how many teen pregnants are in this place, St. Louis and Missouri and Nashville sort of places. Then I see the data of all these and put in my empathy. Of course, I can put in my empathy. When I see my data, I'm able to put in my empathy saying that, oh, I think it makes sense. There are a lot of people culturally. For them, it's a different scene. I cannot put my South Indian mentality over there. For them, the life is different. For them, the teenage is different. So makes absolute sense to me. And then as a product manager, when I take a decision, my decision is right. And it is making absolute sense to both of us as a customer and as a product manager. It's not necessarily just with the product manager. Even when you're a engineer, you were when you are an, you know, someone who is an entrepreneur or a salesperson or scrum master, no matter what, you have to think on system. You shouldn't be like just living with that line of code. Okay, I am supposed to be just building this feature. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. No, that will not land you anywhere. You should think like an entrepreneur. If I own this company, will I be doing this? Will I really listen to the customer and then build something? Will I just go with the data and then build something? So you have to think in system no matter who you are. So voice of customer, I was also been a voice of customer product manager, which is basically listening to the calls and seeing the whole notification of what the customer is actually talking about and what they want and all that. So if you think I will build and then people will buy, it is an amazing movie plan, but nobody is going to buy. Nobody is like literally going to buy just because you built something. They will see what is there for them. And if you can give that essence of keeping the customers in mind, not your enterprise product, not your none of your, you know, metrics or vanity metrics or anything. But if you really keep the customers first and then do it, the unhappy customers are going to really, really help you out build a perfect product. Okay, insights from what they say. This is again one of the call that I'm going to talk about when I was listening to an unhappy customer. So we were building a platform which will make people create disputes on the platform and not make us calls, like I was telling you before. And there was one person who was kept on calling the customer service agents in Omaha in 2019 and 2018. And I was so curious, okay, this person can easily do this on the desktop. They can go to the website and then do it. Why would they call us, wait on the queue, just wait for us to really answer them back. And then it is actually a lot of trouble for them as well. Why are they doing it? Why would they do it? You know, invite a lot of pain for them as well. It was very confusing to me. And then I called this lady and asked her, ma'am, I'm calling from PayPal. And I would like to know that you've called us so many times. When you have a portal, something, she was absolutely unhappy because she had to call again and again. She thought, I'm a customer service agent here, and trying her again and then asking her some stupid questions, that why she is calling so many times. Clearly unhappy. And she said, see, all I have is phone. I purchased the whole product on phone, and all I can do with the phone is call you. Yeah, so now I got the point. So we have a website, we have a beautiful portal, but people don't use desktops. They use phone to buy products. And how can you expect them to go to a desktop to create a dispute when they are unhappy? And your mobile web is not working as effective as your web. So the best, easier way for them to do is, especially for people in the areas like Omaha's and national sort of places, is to call, because it's their usual basic human behavior. This is how you can take insights from unhappy customers. She was clearly unhappy. She was telling me what to do things. And she's an old lady. And now I have to consider my whole backlog, my skills into product management, and whatever I built. This is a news to me. Whatever I built for desktop is useless, because 60 to 70% of the users are buying through mobile. Now I'll have to fix my mobile website or bring it to the app and see how many customers are creating a dispute. Is it worth to bring it to the app? If not, keep it as mobile web, still effective as an app. So these are the decisions I have to take. The customer really helped me. When we fixed it as a team, we were able to make $12 million savings for the company. So if you listen to the unhappy customers, even when they are angry, even when they are unpleasant, even if they are yelling at you, If you listen to it, if you read their mails, if you read the comments across the social media, you can definitely come to an insight. So, small thing here. Today, whatever the companies were with the top Fortune 500 companies like 20 years back or 30 years back, 50% of the companies are not in place anymore. They are bankrupted, they are no more, they are acquired, whatever it is. But there are few companies, like let's say, take the example of Netflix. 10 years back, Netflix was a company which was selling DVDs. And when DVDs were going out of the scene, and people are clearly telling them, hey, I'm not happy about the DVDs anymore because I'm going to, you know, pen drives or whatever the thing is, they did not think like, okay, DVDs are going out of scene. Now let me just start a search engine like Google because they are very successful. They did not think, okay, DVDs are not anymore in scene. Let me just shut this shop, close this business and think of something. No, they didn't do it. They traveled. When the customer said, I'm going to watch it online, they moved online. When they said, I'm going to go with the TV, which is cloud-based, they went with that. They went with a subscription basis. Now, how many purchases today happening from our credit cards today, even without us taking the credit card outside? You know, starting from LinkedIn, Netflix, Amazon Prime, the list just goes on. They traveled with the customer, which was even more easier. Even when the customer was unhappy with the DVD, they heard it, they took the insights from them and still went with them. So they are very successful. Netflix is one of the amazing product that we all use today. So we all can take Netflix as a very good example when it comes to customers. Customers are not loyal, like I always said, to brands, but to quality. We all still buy Amul because the quality is very good. It's still the same ever since my mother was buying a butter. It is same when I'm buying the butter. My daughter loves Amul as well. It is the quality, not because my mother bought something from Saravana stores. Now I go buy from Saravana stores because the quality for me, it is not matching. Probably to my mother, it's a take Saravana Bhavan for that matter. When I was a 10 year, 12 year kid, going to Saravana Bhavan was a dream. buying that idli was like, I have to wait for Pongal and Diwali. So my mother will actually take me to Tinagar and we will go to Saravanabhavan. Today, even if I am dying with hunger, I will really think twice before going to Saravanabhavan because of the quality that they have produced. So because, you know, it gave me a lot of childhood good memories, I will not probably go because the quality is not there. So with customers, even when they are not loyal, even when they are ruthless, even when they are not going to support you in your hard times, they are very, very loyal to your quality. So if you have the quality top notch, if you travel with your customer, then you listen and then take insights from their unhappy statements, your brand can always be on top. So that said, I'm Padmini Janaki again. You can know about me more on padminijanaki.com, where I also post a lot of videos every week, twice a week. And you can also listen to my podcast, which is predominantly done by me and Srinathi. And you can also follow me on Instagram if you want. So that's pretty much about me. Any questions that you guys have? Happy to answer. And that book, I'm going to send it to Bhavani for sending me Marisa Mayer's name. I did not know Fire Phone even existed. Marketing was not satisfied. It's nice reading all your Q&A open chats. So I think I have a question. Now, product manager should handle the customer who is requesting new feature within a timeline, which we cannot adhere and written to ship to our competitor. How did you manage real life scenario? Happens, but it totally depends on what kind of a customer is he or she. They say they are having a subscription with us for $25. So many things. And $25, and then they are asking for a feature which is probably not going to be, you know, used by other users. It's no point really building it. I think you have to put it in a template and really weigh between the value of the customer, the cost value, and the engineering value that you will have to put to build that feature. Is that going to be a scalable solution? Is that going to be sufficing to other customers? I think you, as a product manager, you have to answer a lot of questions, helped with, of course, backed up with data, and then take a decision. If they threaten, I think it's more about the number of threats. It's very subjective with the data that you have. Hope I gave you the answer. Most of the times it is satisfying. Exactly, I gave you the ice cream example, right? So it is most of the times, 99% of the times, it's very, very hard to satisfy all, but it's okay. That's what I'm saying, it is okay. You don't have to be really going behind it. Oh, I'm not able to satisfy them. Am I being a bad business here? No, you don't have to think that way. You can always see how this can be done. But there are a few people who will never go happy. Like, for example, I'll tell you, I sold a course about product management sometime back. There was some around 5,500 people actually signed up for it. And for a brief time, we gave it for free also because of the COVID and all that. You know, even people who got the course for free had so many complaints that, you know, I did not talk about strategy. I did not talk about how to get placed at PayPal. I did not talk about, building a roadmap. When the whole course was about getting into product management and interview preparation, for the 3,000 rupees and 2,000 rupees they pay, they literally want me to go to their house and then do tuition. So it's absolutely not possible. So that's okay. Any other questions? How to become product manager? How many years of experience is required? Balaganesh. So I think there is nothing like you need so and so experience to become a product manager. You can become a product manager even after you're done with the college. If somebody is ready to take up you, there are certain hard skills and soft skills that is required to become a product manager. I've spoken about it also in my course, and also follow Loud Techie. I'm planning to do a video on that. It's a pretty longer topic, but to give a very crisp answer to your question, anybody can become, and I don't think you really need an experience on particular domain to really become a product manager. customers really are the creator of new vision. Yes. Most of the times, yes. Any other questions? If you still have questions, no problem. Not that you will have to put it here, right here. You can connect with me on LinkedIn. If we are not connected on LinkedIn, happy to have you connected on LinkedIn. And of course, on Loud Techie, there is going to be a lot of videos on product management and few other office hacks. And to really have your office life blissful, do subscribe. So you should be able to follow up on that. Does a product manager need to be aware of a Scrum, Agile, and Kanban technologies? Not that you will have to be aware of everything. It's all the process. I'm personally not a big fan of any of the processes as a product manager. But you should know process, like depending upon which company you are and what they follow, Agile and Scrum helps to an extent. What are the strategy steps to trick to turn customer into promoter? Okay. So it is depending upon the feedback they are giving. So that's what we pretty much spoke about for 1 hour. Having an insight, some you can always segregate them into 3 categories. Some just give a feedback emotionally. Some given information or feedback because they were truly hurt when they are truly affected. Some give it for the sake of giving. You have to segregate what kind of a customer are they and try to work on how you can fix it. The first 2 categories can be fixed when the 3rd category is actually not a good use of your time to really fix them. Not everyone should become your promoters. And it's fine. Any other questions? There were 20 questions there. Okay. Shija, are we on time and are we good with the questions?
Yeah. Guys, like if you have any questions, probably can raise in the Q&A section. I believe like Padmini has answered all the question of yours. Still, if you have any questions, like you can raise. Like we have around like 18 minutes more for ending this session.
We don't have to really stretch it for 18 more minutes. We will have the questions if they are coming. If not, it's okay. We will
end. I believe like we have a question from Bala Ganesh.
Share experience about RJing. Okay. I started media, which is visual communication from Etheraj College. And then I started my career as an RJ in a radio station called Hello FM. And I was doing this program called, it was more of a jingles and where we were talking to the customers, talking to the listeners and actually playing a lot of songs. It was also a mixed of programs. And basically, I was doing Summer Tips, which is a Tamil program. And I was talking about what you can do for summer and keep your skin well, your beauty tips and things like that. It used to be a fun days. I think one thing that relates to me even today is understanding the customers. Because when they're not super happy about, they're not going to be on air, and which is going to reflect on your KRAs and OKRs. And even now as a customer, as a product manager, you should keep them all like happy about your product. So I think that the experience of RJing really helped me as a product manager. So yeah, I'm able to also connect into the media lines of companies like The Broadcast and Loud Techie. So I think it really helps me. Thank you.
Okay,
well, good.
Yeah. I believe like everything is good. And thank you so much for making this session very interactive. And so we got a great learning on Friday evening, I would say. And thank you so much, Padmini. So before signing off, I have a news for you all. So as you know, speaker series is intended for a knowledge sharing for every week. And we have a speaker lined up for the next week. So let's see who's on the line. So let me share my screen. All that said, we have Vishwas Mudagal has a speaker series guest speaker for next week. And he's a CEO and co-founder of GoodWorks Co-Working Spaces and GoodWork Labs, which is more into technology and outsourcing. And Vishwas Mudangal is a celebrity entrepreneur and best-selling author and social media influencer. And he's also a motivational speaker, and probably people know him would have seen his Ask Vishwas Vishwas web series, which crossed, like, I would say, like 80 million views. And Mudangal was also honored with ET Now Business Leader for the Year. And he'll be addressing on how the technology and business order gonna change post-COVID-19. So that said, and thank you so much, Padmini, once again for honoring our stage. And thank you everyone for spending your valuable time. And thank you, Padmini.